Good morning, students. Welcome to the virtual classrooms. We are studying this chapter number 5, states of matter. In our last lecture, we studied related to these numericals of ideal gas, combined gas equation. We studied it related to the density. Today we are going to study a new one that is known as Dalton's law of partial pressure. Now, before studying it related to the Dalton's law of partial pressure, it is necessary that we should know the condition under which this law can be applicable. We can have it as an objective question, under what condition this law is applicable. So for that case, this law is applicable only for those gases which are non-reactive with one another. Non-reactive with one another means what? When we take it as in, suppose, nitrogen and hydrogen gas, if we bring them closer to one another in a single container, if I'm filling it as a nitrogen gas from one container and hydrogen gas from the other container and mixing together, what will happen? Immediately nitrogen and hydrogen will react with one another and they will get converted into ammonia, NH3. So that means these gases are reactive with one another. In place of that, if someone says that nitrogen gas is there and to it helium gas is mixed with it, then what will happen? Nitrogen and helium won't react with one another. So such gases are considered to be as a non-reactive gases. So these laws will be applicable if you are going to get a mixtures of non-reactive gases, right? So over there only this law will be applicable. What is that law indicated over there? The law is indicated as the total pressure exerted by the mixture. The total pressure exerted by the mixture of non-reactive gases . See, this is the condition required. Whenever you are having it as a pressure, I want to calculate the pressure of that container, then those should be non-reactive gases is equal to the sum of partial pressure of each gaseous component present in it. What does it change? As already we told that non-reactive gases are there, then whatever the gases are mixed in that container will have a total pressure equals to the sum of partial pressure of each gas is present in them. Now what is the meaning of partial pressure? Partial pressure means the pressure exerted by the gases component, individual gases component. Partial pressure means pressure exerted by individual gases present in the container. That is known as partial pressure. So what does this law say? Total pressure inside the container will be equals to partial pressure of different gases if you have mixed together. I have written it as PA means A gas, partial pressure of that gas, partial pressure of B gas, partial pressure of C gas. If you are knowing the particular gases component, you can indicate its name. You can also indicate it as an P1, P2, P3, right? So P total equals to P1 plus P2 plus P3, like that, right? So that will be the total pressure. That's the Dalton's law of partial pressure. Now using this Dalton's law of partial pressure, we can go for the calculation of many other factors. Like we know it that we are collecting the gases, we are doing the experiments and we are collecting the different gases. Then for collection of the different gases, what we are doing it is, we are always collecting by the downward displacement of water. That means we are allowing the gas to pass through the water and then it is being collected. Now during this case, what will happen? When the gas is passing through the water, if it would have been reactive with the water, then what will happen? It would have dissolved over there, right? Or it would have reacted with that water. But these gases are non-reactive towards the water. They don't react with the water. That's why we are able to collect them. Now, at that time, the temperature of the gases molecules are also higher. So they convert the water into water vapor. So when the gas is collected into the jar, it's not the only dry gas. It also contains certain amount of water vapor also in it. So we can say that when gases are collected over water, then the pressure in the jar will be equals to P is equals to P of dry gas plus P of H2. This is also known as aqueous tension. That means the pressure of water vapor present in the jar. Right? So we always get it as P is equals to P of dry gas plus P of H2O. Or you can say that pressure of only gaseous molecule will be equals to P total minus pressure of H2O. So this is the another formula that we are going to use it for numericals, right? This is one formula that we derived it. Now suppose the question arises, how to calculate the partial pressures? Then so for that case, we are having it as an ideal gas equation. PV is equals to nRT. Using that formula, we can calculate the partial pressure. But suppose again the question arises that if number of moles or pressure, temperature or volumes are not given to us, then how can we calculate the partial pressure? So for that case, we will derive the another formula for it, right? If I want to calculate the partial pressure, if the volume of the container or temperature is not given to me, then so for that case, first of all, we will derive that formula. So for that case, we are considering it for gas A. Let's consider it initially for gas A. Partial pressure will be PA. PA will be equals to NA RT by B, because when we are going it for the experiment, what we are doing it is, we are going to put the volume of the containers in, temperature is kept constant, R is gas constant. So whatever the change we are going to get it will be number of moles. And because of the change in the number of moles, your pressure will be changed. So we will be getting it as PA is equals to NA RT by V. This is known as partial pressure of gas A, right? As we already told it, similarly, for gas B, what will be getting it? PB equals to NB RT by V. For gas C, I'm taking it as in three gases, right? You can have it as in whatever the question is given to us accordingly. Now in this case, I want to find out the P total. What will be getting it? PA plus PB plus PC. But substitute the value of it, we will be getting it NA RT by V, NB RT by V, NC RT by V. So that means NA plus NB plus NC RT by V. This is the formula to calculate the P total if number of moles are given to us, partial pressures are not given. For this, directly without any partial pressures. I don't have PA, PB or PC values, but I am having it as a number of moles given to me, volume given to me, temperature given to me. So I get it by this formula. But suppose if I want to calculate the partial pressure itself, these values are not given to me, then what to do? So temperature is not given, volume is not given. So what we'll do it is dividing, I'm just putting the numbers for the equations. Dividing equation 1 by 4. When I'm dividing the equation 1 by 4, then what will happen? We will be having it as an PA. That is equals to NA RT by B. That is the formula we got it. P total, that is equals to NA NB NC RT by B. Right? Now we are dividing it. So these are the common terms. Can they be cancelled out? So what will left out? PA upon P total. That is equals to NA upon NA NB NC. Can I write this as? It's a mole fraction of A. Moles upon total number of moles. So can we write it as mole fraction? So from this what we got it? PA is equals to XA into P total. So from this formula, can I say that if I want to calculate the partial pressure, partial pressure will be equals to the product of total pressure into mole fraction, right? So for any given case, suppose if I am dividing 2 by 4, we will be getting it as PB upon PT is equals to NB RT by B upon NA plus NB plus NC RT by B. So that means we will get it as mole fraction of B. If I go it for the third, we will get it as mole fraction of C. Or in general, can be write it as partial pressure is equals to the product of total pressure and mole fraction. So that is a formula we will be getting it, right? So this is the another formula. Directly I don't know what is the volume, what is the temperature, but still we can calculate the partial pressure also, right? We will do certain numericals based on these formulas so that you can understand what is the actual conditions or numericals, what type of numericals can be asked. You know it that you are doing the numericals from your textbook, solved, unsolved, they have been there from the exercise. We are doing it as an in the notes, right? But additional to it, some of the numericals for the practice that I am going to give you, and that is the first numerical that we are having it for in practice, right? You can note down the data also in your classwork so that you get an additional questions for the practice. It's given to us a certain quantity of a gas occupies a volume of 0.1 liter when collected over water at 288 Kelvin and 0.92 bar pressure. The same gas occupies a volume of 0.085 liter at STP in dry condition. Calculate the aqueous tension at 288 K. Now see what is given to us or what we want to calculate it. Given to us, it's told to us that there is a gas which is collected over water. That means the volume is given to me, 0.1 liter. P1, that is P total that is given to us. P total is 0.92 bar. At T, 288 K. Now, P total is given to us as 0.92 bar because it's collected over water. So that means it's a dry gas plus aqueous tension, right? We want to calculate, V2 is given to us 0.085 liters at P2, that is given to us, STP means 1 bar and 273 K. We want to find out P of H2O. Aqueous tension means P of H2O. Now see, P total is given to me. P total that is equals to P of dry gas plus P of H2O. Actually P of H2O we want to calculate it. So P of H2O that will be equals to P total minus P of dry gas. Now what is the P of dry gas? P total is known to me. P of dry gas we don't have. So I can't say that this is 1 bar, that is a P of dry gas. So for this case what we will say it is, we will going it for formula P1 V1 by T1 is equals to P2 V2 by T2, and this we will consider it as P total. So from this, can I write it as, for this as P1 is equals to P total minus P, right? That I want to calculate it, P of H2O. This one we will put it as P of dry gas. That is P total minus P of H2O, right? Now P total is given to me, 0.92. P of H2O, it's not there, right? This is going to become as P of dry gas. So let's substitute it over here. 0.92 minus P of H2O. Volume, 0.1 liter. Temperature, 288 K. Right, P2 that is given to us as 1, V2 0.085 and 273. So now can I put it as 0.92 minus P of H2O, that is equals to 1 into 0.085 into 288 upon 0.1 into 273. We can calculate the answer. I am putting it as suppose A. So this one will become P of P2 minus P of H2O, that is equals to A. Therefore P of H2O it will be 0.92 minus A. That will give me pressure in, that is of P of H2O. This will get it as P of H2O. So if I calculate it, we get it as 0.92 minus whatever the answer we got for this, right? So that will give me the aqueous tension of water, right? Okay, let's do it another sum. This one was for aqueous tension. We'll do it one more sum to calculate the partial pressures of the given component. We got that formula also. So let's do it as in another sum for it. It's given to us at sea level the composition of dry air is approximately 75.5% N2, O2 is 23.2% and argon is 1.3% by mass. If total pressure at sea level is 1 bar, what is the partial pressure of each components? Now the percentage of the mass is given to us and we are told to find out the partial pressure of each component. So from this percentage by mass it is given to me, can I say that if we consider total mass that is equals to 100 gram, can I say that N2 is 75.5 gram, O2 23.2 gram, argon 1.3 gram, right? Once we get it the mass, we told it the total is 100. So what will get it? Moles of N2, that is mass of N2 upon 28, that will give me a certain moles of N2. Same way, O2, moles of O2, we will get it as 23.2 by 32 moles of argon, 1.3 divided by 40. So we will get it as moles. Let's consider that this is N1, N2, N3. You can calculate it by using your calculator, right? Now what will be this? Mole fractions, we got it. I want to calculate the partial pressure, right? If the total pressure at the sea level is given to me 1 bar, that means the P total is given to us. P total, that is 1 bar. So what will be the P of N2? Can I say that P of N2 is equals to P total into mole fraction of N2? P total is 1. Mole fraction of N2 will be N1 upon N1 plus N2 plus N3. That we got it. We will get it as P of N2. Similarly, for P of O2, P total into X of O2, so that means we will be getting it as 1 into N2 upon N1 plus N2 plus N3. Similarly, P of AR, that is P total into argon, 1 into N3 upon N1 plus N2 plus N3, right? So we will be getting it as P of N2 as A, P of O2 we will get it as B, P of argon will take it as C. We got it as partial pressure of each component present in the given composition at a sea level, right? So this is what we can have it as a change in the questions, right? Some of the data might be changed, temperature might be changed, number of mass may be changed, moles may be given to you. Sometimes it may be in place of this by mass, in place of that we would have written it at by moles. So what will happen? This one will become as in, this answer itself will become as in moles, right? So like that the changes can be done in the numericals. We are having it as in some of the numericals for the practice in our book. So try to do for it. Okay. Now the next one. This was the numericals that we saw it. Our next theory that we are having it. We are having that theory to be divided into number of parts. This was the last section where you were having it as a numericals. Right. Now particularly for this chapter we won't have the numericals. We are having it only as in theoretical parts. Right. wherever will be required, I will be writing it as in points, but majority you can read it in the book and get the answers for it. Right? It's a theoretical part. So I'm not going to write all those things on the board. Only the thing is, we will discuss it orally. Like our next theory that we are having it, that is kinetic energy and molecular speed. Now, when we are talking about kinetic energy and the molecular speed, what we want to indicate it? That whenever you are having it as in gases, we have studied in our lower standard right from there till today, even in this chapter also we discussed the characteristic of the gases molecules, that they are not steady, they are always in a continuous motion. That means they are having it as a certain kinetic energy present in them. They are in a continuous motion. Now if they are having it as a kinetic energy, is all the gaseous molecules though made up of same composition? Like suppose if I say it as an 1 mole of an N2 gas is taken, we are having it as an 6.022 into 10 raised to 23 number of N2 molecules. Does all the molecules move with the same speed? The answer is, we can't say it that it moves with the same speed. They are having it as a different speeds. They are not moving with the same kinetic energy. Now what is the reason behind it? Now reason we can give it is, we know that gaseous molecules, they are in a continuous motion, but at the same time when they are moving it, they will collide with one another. I can't say that like when two persons are running on the opposite direction, they found it that they are coming opposite to each other, they change the path and move away, right? Two students, when you are running it into some field track, if you are coming closer to one another, what will change? You will change your path and move away. Do the gases comes to know it? No. What will happen? Gases will collide with one another. When they collide with one another, what happens? They will transfer their energies. While they are transferring their energies, what will happen? Some of them will have a higher energy, some of them will have lower energy. So as a result, their speed will change. The motion of the molecules will change. So this change in the speed of the gaseous molecules, they are not always found it to be the same. So what we do it is, we calculate the average speed. So for that case, we write it as the speed in the form of U average. That is the U1 plus U2 plus U3 upon N. Whatever the number of molecules that you are calculating it, we always get it as average molecular speed. So we calculate that average molecular speed as the molecular speed of the first molecule plus second molecule plus third molecule upon whatever the number of molecules we are having it. So we write the formula of U average, right? But again, when this theory was being given out, at that time the two scientists, Maxwell and Boltzmann, they told that it's not necessary that every molecules will have an identical speeds. The molecular speeds depends upon even temperature of the molecules. Not only by colliding with it they change their speed, but they also depend upon the average temperature of that container, the gaseous molecules. The reason is, if the temperature is increased, molecules will get in kinetic energy and they will move faster. If the temperature is brought down, the molecules won't have that energy, so they will slow down. So that means, they told that they also depend upon the temperature. So they plotted the graph. They plotted the graph of the gaseous molecules, the speed of that molecules for two different temperatures. They found it that the graph they got it was not an identical graph. This one was at T1, this one was at T2. It was found that T1 was less than T2. So what does it choose? That if your temperature is increased, if your temperature is changed, the total compositions, the speed of that molecules will be changed, right? So this shows that if the temperature is increased, then your molecular speed will be changed, right? So now these are not the average speeds, so they are considered as an molecular probability speeds. We considered as molecular probable speeds. So it is indicated as UMP, right? This is not average, this is given out as UMP. Now we know that this depends upon kinetic energy, half mv square. Kinetic energy is given out as half mv square, right? But what is that v, velocity? We will be getting it as average speed whole square, right? So we will be getting it as the mean square velocity, that will be given out as UMP. We will be getting it as half m u square v. Okay, now when we are calculating the u square, what does this u square indicates to us? Then this u square is going to indicate to us as root mean square velocity. That means we are calculating the square of it, so we are going to get it as the new term as root mean square velocity, URMS, that is equals to u bar whole square, right? So these three different velocities that we are getting it for the gaseous components when they are going for it, which indicates that URMS will be greater than U average, will be greater than UMP, right? So when we are having this type of values, then the ratios that we are getting it, considering that if this is one, this one will be U average, will be greater, U average value, we will be having it as 1.128, where UMP we will be getting it as 1.22, right? So this is what we get it as, kinetic energy and molecular speed. We get it as three types of speeds: U average, U molecular speed, and U RMS, root mean square velocities. Okay, is it? That's a theoretical. You can read it in our textbook. It's given to us as a point wise. You can go through it, right? Rest theory, that is related to the gaseous molecules, whatever the changes, ideal gas conditions are not there, then what will be the change in the theory? But that we'll discuss it in our next lecture. Till then, thank you.